Hey everyone, welcome back to another edition of the Round Table. I'm here with my guys, the Godfather, Jim Chapman and Rick Usser. How we doing, everybody?
Good.
I may regret this, but today is a little segment we like to call Tee It Up. I just want to know, what's going on in the airgun world? What's on your mind? Godfather,
please.
I'm going to start with you.
Please. Would they please stop putting fiber optic sights on airguns? Optic sights. You can't hit anything with a fiber optic sight.
So you're talking about the little orange and green thing.
They're so cool and everybody likes them. Nobody who shoots likes them.
Anybody that shoots outside their garage doesn't like them.
Right. Doggone it all. We used to have such beautiful open sights on spring guns. And now these stupid fiber optic sights, half of them aren't even branded fiber optics, so they don't even catch the light. They're just little red tubes.
You're sounding decidedly grumpy.
I need to take a bad time.
He likes the really fine precision metal sights, and I'm with you if you're going to shoot it. You know, targets. Man, if you're hunting, though, I really like those fiber optics, man. They're quick target acquisition.
It depends on the gun. You know, if I have an heirloom German Springer, I want to have a really nice sight on it. But if I'm taking, you know, one of the typical lower-cost guns, I think they work just fine.
What do you care? You put a scope on everything.
I was going to say, but you beat me to it. I don't really care because I'll scope it. And I'm going to take them off or cut them off if I have
to. My biggest problem with some of those is that they sit up high. And some of the scopes I put on, they're in my line of sight on my scope.
Sir.
And so I've either got to zoom past them, which I don't always want to, or it's just a distraction and something, trust me, I do not need any more distractions.
Right, absolutely.
And the front fiber optic sights, if they don't put a hood over that front tube, I break it when I cock the gun.
Yeah.
Just about every time.
Mine is that, you know, from the SHOT Show, the big thing were big bores and bullpups.
Yeah.
And I want to talk about bullpups. That's a real...
I'm sorry, bullpup.
Bullpup are form following function. But people get them. I ask people, why do you want a bullpup? Because it's compact, it's lightweight. It's not. Almost all the bullpups I shoot, I'll come back to what it is.
Okay.
Almost all of them I shoot are heavier than a rifle that they're derived from. So why do you really want it? If it's just because you think it looks cool, that's okay. But if you're saying it's because it's the most ergonomic compact package, unless you've got a scope mounted camera on it, I don't think so. I think a good carbine is better. Bullpup is a gun where the receiver and the trigger unit are moved back behind the shooter, and the trigger then has to be moved forward. And there's usually some type of a linkage moving the new trigger back to the primary trigger, especially if the gun is derived from an existing rifle model.
Yeah.
So it's like, if you really like a bullpup, that's cool. You can like anything you want.
Thank you.
But be honest about why you want it.
Because I do like it.
Be honest, it looks cool.
It does look
that's
cool.
Why
like
you like
the
it.
Evenix, what is it?
They have the ML and
Max,
the Max.
They're awesome.
They're pretty cool.
They're
awesome.
But see, I guess part of it, when I'm out hunting, I like it to be part of the experience. That's why I like wood stocks. It's just, for me, I grew up reading all of Sports of Field and all O'Connor and
me
Rourke
too.
And all the great hunters, and they're always out there with their rifles that look like sporters, their wood, and to me that's part of the experience.
And Tonto, but I mean,
no,
you know,
rifleman
at some point
had a lever action.
You know, you can't go with everything that you saw on TV when you're eight. Sometimes there's these cool. Ooh. Sometimes these new
Rossi, you're
tactical.
You're projecting. I wasn't watching TV. I was reading.
Oh, that's true. That's like watching TV, only completely different.
Dang, it's the TV for the intelligent.
Yes.
All right, I can respect that though, because some of them are. You shoot them because they're cool. They don't necessarily add.
And I've got five or six, and I use them because actually where I find them useful is if I'm shooting inside of a truck. Because they're easy to move around, but they're not lightweight. They're not easier to.
What's a timeout?
Shooting inside a truck. I'm not shooting at things in the truck.
Your passengers just get really nervous. They're in Africa.
When I'm in the bush. Slash my truck.
I'll tell you something funny. I'm
talking
about pest control out of a car, and you do that sometimes. But I had a
redneck hunt at its best.
I had a rental SUV, and I was up in Northern California, and we were doing a rabbit hunt in a place they had a huge problem. And we were driving through the fields and shooting the rabbits. And I actually had a bullpup, and I saw a rabbit, and I went to shoot it, and I didn't realize the mirror was was right in front of the barrel, and I had the scope looking over, and I blew out their mirror. So when I brought the rental car back, they said, "What happened?" I said, "Vandals. I left it in a grocery store, and somebody smashed my
reason
mirror."
Reason number 212 why you shouldn't shoot a gun out of a car.
Out of a car, right.
Just saying.
That's hilarious.
All right, off to you, sir. What do you got? What's on your mind?
I think mine's going to be more practical and relevant to right now.
Okay.
I hate misleading marketing on the boxes.
For instance?
For instance, you go and you're gonna go to the store and you're gonna get that gun. We've had discussions about how to buy a gun, right? Mm-hmm. You go up and you see feet per second that's unrealistic, mm-hmm. or you see advertising on theoretical game you could possibly take at various yardages mm-hmm. that are completely unrealistic. The gun doesn't have the power, it doesn't have the accuracy. But they're putting unrealistic expectations into the consumer's head. They buy that gun, they take it home, it doesn't perform. Now, all air guns are junk.
Bad. Yeah.
And that really hurts the sport, and it's done purely to sell the gun off the shelf, and it's just out. I mean, it's more than just fudging a bit. It's just, I think
it's
they're just
misleading. Just misleading. But you know what? Yeah. Okay, so you win. You had probably the most relevant one. I'll give you that. Better than fiber optics, better than bullpups, which are, I was kind of whinging and moaning, but I agree with you, actually.
Yeah, that one just drives me, as a critic, that's what I'm just constantly fighting against.
So many emails that say, what type of a pellet should I use in my new 177 brake barrel to shoot pigs?
Yeah.
I get so many of those.
Even I know better than that.
Yeah.
So, okay, so good round, guys, well done on teeing it up here. Let's take it again. What things are on your mind that you're loving about the world of air guns?
All the new big bores.
Yeah.
Tons of big bores coming out.
Yeah, there are a lot of them. And they had guns that were going from the 100 foot pound range up to 600 foot pound. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was an air gun for just about any game you could conceivably take with an air gun. And what I really love are they're coming out of mainstream manufacturers now, not the boutique builders.
Yeah, not niche.
And that shows that there's a growing market because these companies don't invest in those type of guns if they don't see a return on that investment.
Right. Yeah.
So I think it bodes well for the sport.
Yeah.
Is that bad for the boutique guys?
No, because there are still people that are going to want one of those guns.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, because they're pieces of art.
Most of these guys are so backlogged, if you want one of their guns, you have to wait forever to get it. I mean, yeah. There are so many people that want them. And that may fall off a bit, but there will still be people that want a really different, custom, fine gun.
Yeah, there's always going to be that,
yeah,
for sure.
I got one for you that doesn't yet exist, but it really could. Last year, Dennis Quackenbush and I did an experiment, and I documented it in Shotgun News, called the $100 PCP.
Okay.
We took a Crossman 2100, which is a multi-pump that costs $60. Dennis converted it into a PCP by just putting a tank on it with a fill nipple, and that was it. No gauge, no special barrel. We didn't change the valve. We didn't change anything about the gun. Mm-hmm. This gun could have been built for about $7 more than the original gun was built, because some of the parts that you build the original gun with wouldn't have been included. So you would have had a savings. Mm-hmm. And that $10 reservoir mm-hmm. would have been your only expense. The gun shot at 2,000 PSI instead of 3,000, so it's very easy to fill
Makes
from
a lot
pump.
Of sense. Mm-hmm.
I got 10 good shots, and without tuning the valve, that's remarkable. Mm-hmm. When I say good shots, I'm talking about putting 10 shots inside a quarter at 25 yards with a scoped gun. I was over 800 feet per second with a 177 caliber pellet. Mm-hmm. We proved the concept of the $100 PCP, and here's my point. PCPs, there's a resistance in the market to PCPs. People are afraid. They're afraid, I don't know how to fill it. They're afraid, I have to buy all this other stuff. Mm-hmm. They're afraid, I don't want to spend that kind of money and not like it. I think if we had something that was not only just affordable, but incredibly affordable. Mm-hmm. And they could buy it, and they would see, this is really simple. It's just a pump-up gun without the pump.
Yeah. Right.
I could do this. Then they're going to say, okay, I'll buy that $400, $500, $600 PCP. I like this.
How are they going to fill it?
That's the problem. The problem is there are only $200 pumps or $600 carbon fiber tanks or $1,800 compressors. Dennis Quackenbush came up with a way that Crossman can make a pump for $100. And I told that to Crossman, how they can go ahead and get a pump that'll retail. But still, if the gun costs $100, you're asking the guy to also buy a pump for $100.
So the $100 air gun is becomes a $200 air gun.
Yeah, there's no way around that kind
sure.
of thing. Yeah.
Could you put like a straw on it?
Well, you no? might have the pressure.
So you're excited about the possible future of maybe the PCP airgun world.
I am.
All right.
I'll dovetail that for just a second. I agree that PCP.
Now we're gonna move on past that. What are you excited about? Yeah, I know. Just like that. It's called the moderator.
Look at that. Look at what he does.
Look at who's in control.
Look, yeah. Okay.
He's moderating.
Yeah.
Okay.
Moderator. Wait. So this is what I'm really excited about. It's kind of new to me, and that's the action. Competitive action shooting with air guns.
Okay.
You know, I've had replica pistols. They've not been more than just shooting tin cans. Okay. Mm-hmm. They're just, you shoot paper at 10 yards, shoot tin cans, shoot simple objects, but there was nothing that really was a sport that you could maybe take those into, nothing beyond that plinking in the backyard. Now there is. And right. that the program is called IASS for International Air Shooting Sports. And you can take, it's very competitive, very fast moving. You're shooting a pistol, you're shooting an airsoft shotgun, and you're shooting some sort of semi-automatic sporter pellet gun or airsoft gun. And man, it's a lot of fun. And it gives place to these products, which really didn't have a competitive arena to be in.
Right.
That for me is very exciting.
Unless you were shooting your buddy.
Well,
I mean, those, you know, where you run over like the paintballs.
Well, yeah, the skirmishing. Right, yeah. Yeah, I never really did much of that.
Oh, it's awesome. I will say it is awesome.
Can I add one more?
Yes, one more.
Okay, it's not the guns themselves. There are more states that are opening up their hunting regulations to allow hunting with air guns.
He's right.
Every year they add more. Yeah. In Arizona, Arizona opened up every game season in the state except elk. You can hunt anything in the state. You can hunt coos deer, whitetail, javelina, bear, mountain lion, antelope, and there every year it seems like another state or two opens up either big game or they clarify their laws on small game. Mm-hmm. And it's getting to a point where being able to do some type of air gun hunting is possible in just about every state. So I think that is a huge trend.
Cool. Very excited for all of us.
Yep.
All right, that's it for this round table. We got more American Airgunner coming up, so stay with us. And remember, go to our website for any more information on what we discussed today, AmericanAirgunner.com. We'll be back.